There's Hinduism and Hindutva. Can you explain a little bit of a subtle difference between the two words, at least, actually, what they are actually trying to say or teach us or actually progress further, at least? Okay, so that's one question. The second question is, obviously, in Hinduism, we have lots of things, at least, that this is doing this is good for you, this is bad for you, or whatever. So we don't have actually 10 commandments, but they are like commandments, actually. So could you, if I decided, at least, I just want to follow one commandment, which one should I follow?
Okay, first of all, as you most of you hopefully know, in Christianity, the reason why you are Christian is because you follow the teachings of Christ. Wonderful idea. You are Buddhist because you follow the teaching of Buddha. Wonderful. And of course, long time ago, we had a Mr. Hindu. We said, hello chaps, follow me. I'm Mr. Hindu. You become Hindus. You actually believe that? I hope not. I'm worried now. We didn't have Mr. Hindu. So what is the word Hindu and Hinduism, Hindutva? What is the background to it? The word Hindu is just nothing more than a mispronunciation of a very name of an ancient river called River Sindhu that flowed in northwest part of India, ancient India. It was called Sindhu. And Sindhu in Sanskrit means a river, large flow of water. That's what it literally means. So that was the name. And somehow it got mispronounced and people blamed the Persians saying they'd messed it up and called it Hindu instead of Sindhu. Sa became her. I say no, I suspect the Gujaratis are responsible. Especially if you come from Kathiawad and Kutch. We've got a habit of changing the sa into ho. Have you noticed that? Instead of saying su haim ja, hu haim ja, hakna beho, you know, like that. So we turned the sa into ho. Maybe we are to blame, but we like to point a finger at the Persians. But the sa became her, and that's how the word Hinduism arose. So it has no real Sanskrit meaning as such. It's the name of a river, Sindhu. And then the story went further, and just out of interest, I'm telling you. Then we had the Greeks turning up, and their problem with the ha sound. They turned the ha into a. The river Sindhu had become Hindu. Is down into Indus. And they say people living across the river Indus are people of Indoi, India. So even the name of the country is mispronunciation of the river. So that's how we are stuck. But so be it. So what is this idea? The name that we give to our tradition, if I can use the right word, is Dharma. Now Dharma means something quite different from the word religion. Religion means realigning humanity with some super personality called God. Hello, Chia God, I'm here, link of humanity. This is religion. The four Indian traditions, I've used the word tradition, Hinduism, Buddhism, Jainism, Sikhism, none of them use the word religion. Actually, even though we use it, you know, in a very casual manner, the word is dharma. They're all dharmic tradition. Even the Buddhists call it dhamma. It's dharmic tradition. What's the difference? Dharma's, the enterprise of dharma is saying, make sense of the human condition, resolving it here and now. This is the meaning of the word dharma. What is underpinning this reality? Let me come to terms with it. Who am I? What am I doing here? Let me sort myself out. This is the enterprise of dharma. So in Buddhism, there's no God, for example. So dharma is a different word. Now, how does the word... So the Hinduism, as I said, is a meaningless word, really. And the reason why the word Hindutva arose, let me tell you the background, is this. People get worked up. They say, when you say ism, means it's something that's output of something else. You know, ism means it is something that has been compromised. That is why the people who are very worked about Hindu, you know, they say, we don't want to use Hinduism, we say Hindutva. The essence of this tradition, essence of this, that's what it means, literally means. So Hindutva is basically to shy away from the word ism. That's the reason why they invented it. It's just play of words, basically, when you think about it. Nothing serious. Neither of them does justice to what this tradition is all about, which is dharma, making sense of the human condition. The second question you ask is this. You may think that Hinduism doesn't have the 10 commandments. We actually have. And they are called, they're part of the Patanjali Yoga Sutra. They're called Yama and Niyama. Yama are disciplines, 5 disciplines. Satya, Ahimsa, Asteya, Aparigraha, Brahmacharya. And Niyama has got 5 observances. Saucha, Santosh, Tap, Swadhyay, Ishwar, Pranidhan. You may say, oh, Dilipai, this is too much. Evening time, leave us alone. He said, just give me one. And the one that I'd like to give you is, the one that I like, that even the secular world will like. You know, the world that doesn't believe in religion, these vegetative people out there are like that. So be it. I don't mind them. I think they are much more, they're better because they're less brainwashed. So what is the best, if like, kind of discipline that I can suggest? The word is Satya. Yeah. Now Satya, you may sound truthfully, so Mr. Lakhani, we are all nice, honest people. What do you think? You already follow Satya? I say, oh, you don't really? He said, oh, yes, we do. And let me tell you, you don't. When you say you are kind of steadfast in satya, what does it mean? It means you must be stickler. I tell you how bad it is, how difficult it is. It simply says, just be, don't go into philosophy, what is truth and all that. Don't waste your time with all this high philosophy. Simply saying, what you think and what you say must match up. You must be joined up inside. So what you think and what you say must match up. And what you say you must do, that must match up too. This is the only thing about satya. What you think, what you say and what you do must match up. Become joined up within your system, otherwise you're disjointed, you know, like that. This is the idea of satya. You may think, why is it important? Look, I tell you how difficult it is. You need to be stickler. Suppose you meet somebody, just now you met somebody, and you say, oh, not her again. Oh, God. Oh, nice to meet you. You don't mean it, do you? But if you say that, you are in big trouble straight away. You lose your position in the interfaith, everything goes wrong for you. So you say, oh, it's so nice to meet you. Going, oh, not her again. But this is, if you like, see how we compromise. In the name of being diplomatic, we compromise like that. This is not allowed. So this is, you will lose all your friends very quickly. And the second part is even more difficult. And I suffer from it as well. It's this. What you say, you can't sometimes fulfill. Suppose I told Amisha, I'll be here today. And suppose I'm not well today. I'm in trouble. I have to do what I said. I have to come sneezing and wheezing as I'm here now. Tolerate me. See, this is what it means to be stickler for truth. You may say, Mr. Lakhani, in this day and age, surely you must kind of cut corners and be a little diplomatic, and you can't be 100% sure that what you say you're going to be able to fulfill. But my friend, I'm telling you, this is from my mentor, Sri Ramakrishna. He said, if you are a stickler for truth, try it. Stickler. Look, I fail every time, because I think in the name of diplomacy, I sometimes compromise. He said, you be stickler for truth. Do you know what will happen? He says, your inner system will be so joined up, you are ready to go into deep meditation. This is the only discipline that lead you. Just one discipline will take you to the highest spiritual experience. So this is, if you like, the prize that awaits if you just follow one out of these 10. And the fifth one I didn't go into, which is called Brahmacharya. We'll talk about it some other time. Take some more questions.
I had some Hindu friends at university who were vegetarian, so I was just wondering how vegetarianism links in with Hinduism.
Okay, first let me be very clear. People somehow feel that unless you're vegetarian, you can't be Hindu. This is not true. Let me tell you, actually there was research done by a major newspaper in India about a few years back, to see how many Hindus are vegetarian in India. Forget about UK. In India, they did research. And they went to all the different states and interviewed so many people, you know, do the surveys, whatever way. And they found, when I saw it, I was like, oh dear. 60 or sometimes 70% of people in India, Hindus in India, I should say, either eat meat, fish, seafood, or eggs. 60 to 70% of Hindus in India. If you are a Bengali, you can't live without fish. So, you see, let me be very clear. The Hindu tradition has never imposed vegetarianism. The Jain tradition, are there any Jains here, by any way? The Jain tradition has been vegetarian. It's because of the Jain influence, many Gujaratis have become vegetarian. Because of the Jains, they are the culprits. They will be going to McDonald's every day. So the Jain tradition brought in the idea of vegetarian, because they said, look, life is sacred. And what's the background to this beautiful background? In fact, Jainism is ahead of its time. He said, look, all life is sacred. What a wonderful idea. He said, okay, if you need to survive and live on living things, then live on the least evolved living things, plants maybe. But don't live on the most highly evolved things. We are very close for comfort. Don't live off them or kill them. This is the idea. And the staunch Jains will not even eat green plants, you know that? Only dead leaves. I mean, I can't live like that. But this is how severe they are. Don't underestimate. They are saying, just as the Hindus are stickler for the idea of, say, satya, they are stickler for the idea of ahimsa, non-violence. It's a central feature. No God, just be ahimsa will take you to the highest level. This is Jainism. So it is very much a Jain influence that many Hindus are vegetarian like me today. Now what is the situation now? As I said, the Vedic scriptures basically simply said, revere all life, including the plant life. If I'm saying I'm such a lovely chap, I eat just tomatoes and, you know, carrots, and they say, oh no, still living things, you're munching somebody's baby there. So, see, we are in trouble straight away. So we are aware of it. We are simply saying we are cursed, if I can use the right word, to live on other living things. So best thing is to live on the least evolved rather than the most evolved living things. That's one thing. Second thing, this is again very interesting. Modern sciences are now suggesting strongly good evidence that vegetarianism is good for your health. So it has got health benefits, now becoming visible. Before, until now it was hidden away, becoming visible. The most important reason why people should be vegetarian is this. And I go to many English girls' school and I ask them, how many vegetarian? Boys are all well, mature, they eat anything that comes in around. But the girls are very sensitive. Many girls that I come across in English girls' school say we are vegetarian. I say, why? They say, we hate the idea of cruelty to animals. When we see these animals herded for human consumption, the way they are treated, the way they are killed and murdered and butchered, and then you have to eat that. We told our mummies, no more meat, mummy. I say, I love this. You see, this is how it should be heartfelt, something that you feel and you want to give up. That's the natural way of being vegetarian rather than being imposed by religion. So this is the position of the Hindus regarding vegetarian. It's a good question to explore. Thank you, madam.
According to Hinduism, what is the ultimate liberation, you know, in the context of moksha? Because other religions say that there is just only one life. There is no life after life. I mean, there is no next birth. So what about Hinduism says about it?
Okay. That's what. You see, please round of applause. If you look at the situation in the world today, look at all the whole of humanity, there are three major worldviews. There may be others. The three major, one is the atheistic worldview. They say this life is the only life you've got, Mr. Lakhani. Leave it to the fool and forget about all this airy-fairy stuff being reborn, all that. It's just to give you comfort in death. There's no such thing. This is the only life you focus on. Life before death counts, not life after death. This is how they talk to me and I say, I like you. So they value life. What's wrong? Nothing wrong. This is one approach. And you must appreciate why they are adopting this. Like David Hume was a major philosopher. He lived a very peaceful, lovely life. And he said, okay, end is coming, I'm dying. No, he's not worked up about it, dying. So I love this kind of people. So I have no problem with this idea of first approach, atheistic approach, saying this is the only life, make the most of it. Don't wait on the next life. Good idea. The second scenario we have from the Abrahamic tradition, Judaism, Christianity, Islam, is the idea of a two-life scenario. Sometimes they say this purgatory, a place where you get tidied up, cleaned up. But this is, if you like, the second version. I won't go into great depth about it, but this is, if you like, the Christian version. And in a way, it is very important. Do you know why? What's the selling point? It makes sure that the devotees are true devotees. They are stickler for the religion because they can't risk it in case they go in the wrong place. So they become very devout. They can't sit on the fence. So in a way, it focuses their attention on being truly religious. So that's the positive side. The negative side, I must mention this, that creates fanatics. Because they want to go and achieve that, they might as well blow themselves up here. See, this is the negative part. It creates fanatics. Because this two-life scenario, this infinitely skewed risk-reward ratio produces fanatics. This is the negative part. The positive part, it tells the people, be truly religious here and now, this life. Be truly, true religious. The third scenario is, of course, the idea of reincarnation. Buddhist tradition call it slightly different. They call it rebirth for technical reasons. I won't go into that. But the idea of reincarnation is central in the four Indian religions. Yes, we've been born again and again, we'll come again and again, and we continue our spiritual journey over many lifetimes. It has been going on for a long time, it is not going to finish that easily. Because you've got so many frustrations and desires and unfulfilled desires that you need to fulfill, so you'll find another body and you'll come back and carry on your journey. But the good part about it is it gives you measured reward for the measured risk you take or the measured work you do. Suppose you're a musician in one life, and you died early for whatever reason, the effort that you put in is not lost. It stays part of your mental mode. And when you're reborn, according to the Hindu tradition, that feature appears, makes itself visible at a very early stage. So you become a child prodigy, you know, become Mozart and start composing operas. So this is the positive. Your journey doesn't stop with one life. It gives you measured reward for the measured work you put in. This is the positive side. Is there a negative side? The Hindus are saying, it can't be negative, it's a lovely idea. We like the chocolate cake, we'll come back again and have it again next life. This is not a lovely idea. So how can Mr. Lakhani, there's a negative side, there's a negative, very dangerous negative side, and you are very aware of it. Do you know what's the negative side of reincarnation? People don't realize it, but I watch it and I know. The Hindus say, you see, we have got so many opportunities to be born and reborn, and this religious journey and meditating and, you can wait. In this life, Bollywood, let's go for these dancing girls. So they forget about making serious spiritual progress in this life because they got so many opportunities, they let it go. This, that, they are laid back about religion. And how do we know? Amisha was just telling me in the car, there's a huge Hindu community here, and how many have turned up here today? Just look at it. They become too laid back. This is the negative part of reincarnation. People don't realize we have a negative. This is the negative part. Because it says, oh, no rush. Actually, I prefer this kind of more focus of saying, no, in this life I want to sort it out. And the question that the gentleman asked was, what is the end solution? What happens? The end we call, in the Hindu tradition we call moksha. In the Jain tradition they call nirvana. We call it moksha. Now moksha is a beautiful Sanskrit term. We say moha kshaya. When your delusion regarding what is this reality, why am I chasing after pleasurable things, and I must have that, and I must marry that beautiful wife, all this delusion that you have about fulfilling your desires, and how you hope that when you marry the beautiful girl, things will be sorted out, they don't get sorted out. Ask anybody who's married a beautiful lady. So they carry on. Other issues arise. No end of them. And you say, oh God, that was a delusion. So moksha means moha kshaya, end of delusion. And this doesn't happen easily. Only after getting tremendous beating, we just say, oh God, we were chasing after shadows. It didn't produce the result I was looking for. And when that maturity arises in any individual, he's ready now for the genuine search of what is his true nature. And the only way this ends is when you discover your essential nature is not what you thought it was. Essentially, you are the chip of the old block, the spirit. And when you don't believe in it, don't just think about it, don't just accept it, you actually experience it. Desires drop off. You become the, if you like, instead of being a slave of this world that around you, you become the master. This is called moksha. This is the aim of the Hindu life, to outgrow desires, outgrow this delusion that we're chasing after all our lives.
I was brought up believing that if you've done good deeds in this life, then you will be you'll be born again as a human being. Whereas if you've done bad deeds, then you'll, you know, take birth as an animal or an insect. How does that tie in?
When people are angry with you, they say, because you are so naughty, you're going to become a dung beetle, and I'm going to step on you. Now, it's highly unlikely, by the way. I'll tell you why. And why do we have such huge human population? 7 billion. They were started like a handful out of Africa, about 70,000 years. Why? Billion? What's happening? 7 billion. Where do they come from? All this. The answer is, life comes from the insect to the animal to the human. Huge amount of life flowing. The physical body we have is chiseled by natural selection. We agree with Darwin. But the stuff that's inhabiting this body and mind complex, is something that comes through reincarnation. So we say that a lot of huge amount of life force is coming into the human kingdom, and it's very happy here. He wants to stay around. Doesn't want to go again to moksha. Just want to be born again and again, enjoy life. Or keep, you know, thinking they're enjoying life. So there's a huge population. So once you're in the human kingdom and you're tested the intellect, you see, this is the power of the human frame. We have the intellect, make sense of the world, put things into boxes and link them up. This is the power of intellect. Once you've tasted that, it's highly unlikely you're going to become a dung beetle. Highly unlikely. At the same time, we are very open saying that if somebody behaves in such a brutal manner, he's a brute, he's operating like a brute, so he's just on the borderline of being promoted in the human kingdom, he may decide to slip back in and be a brute. But again, we say once he has tasted human life, he'll come back very quickly. So he may just go down for a little dip and then come back again to the human life. But going back to becoming a little bacteria and starting in somebody's nose is highly unlikely. So it's a very mature system. Once you're in the human kingdom, you kind of bob along here. And majority don't go back in the animal kingdom. And this is, again, another thing, be careful. They'll say, oh, and this isn't, they sing bhajans in Gujarati. If you miss this human birth, you're going to start from scratch. You don't start from scratch, you've done enough scratching now. You are here now, and you want to carry on. So you bob along here, you will learn your lesson through hard, sometimes through hard times, but then that's how we progress.
Mine is just about reincarnation. Where's the proof that we do come back as something else? Is it really?
Look, even though I kind of wear this kind of Hindu garb or kind of promoting Hinduism, my background is actually physics and science. So I would not believe anything unless I really it made sense to me and I had some genuine, convincing evidence about it. Otherwise, I would not believe in it. And this is very important. So So I was looking around thinking, this does sounds too floaty, airy-fairy, this reincarnation stuff can't be real. And I looked around quite a lot. I actually am like that. I don't believe anything unless I can make sense of it. I won't agree. Even in the name of Hinduism, I'll still spit it out. And one good thing that I found, and you should find if I need to, is the Hindus just believe it. They don't really do much research on it. There's one professor called Professor Ian Stevenson, who was based in the University of Virginia. He, for 40 years, he researched reincarnation. 40 years, all his life. And this was University of Virginia. And this is his discovery. First, he tried to put people into hypnotic regression, see if they can go back to a previous life. He said, no, everybody becomes a Cleopatra, no good. So he gave it up. Then the other way he found, where he did proper research, is he found a lot of three-year-old children, boys and girls from all religions, no religion, throughout the world, who suddenly spontaneously remember another life, spontaneously, without any prompting, without any fraud. There are thousands of them. So whenever he finds them, he's told straight away. So he'll fly out with his translators because they speak different language. He'll interview the little poor boy or the girl and quiz the poor little chap again and again, asking 100 questions, fill files, written, all tape recorded. He's done research on 3,000 children to recall their past life. 3,000. This is in University of Virginia. And the research continues. But they still don't prove reincarnation. Maybe they're just babbling, just making it up, making up stories. And this is how they start. You know, say, boy gets up, mommy, my name is not David, it's John. Of course, get a smack straight away. No, you are David. No, mommy, I'm John. And by the way, mommy, I'm married. You are 3-year-old, you're married. Oh, yes. And by the way, I got 3 children. You have 3 children as well. Yes, and these are their names. They give you the names. This is how the story unfolds. And they give tremendous information in a matter-of-fact voice. They just, you know, pour out this information that gets recorded. Still not proof of reincarnation. But then Professor Stevenson found that in many cases possible to check out what they're talking about. And this is where he hit the jackpot. And he took the journalist from Washington Post saying, come with me, see what I'm doing. I'm asking the science lobby. He says that he's a hard-headed scientist. He says, I'm asking the science lobby to explain how these two lives are linked. How does this chap know of this life that was lived 50 years ago? How does he know? What is the link? Is there any genetic link? Zero. No uncles, aunts, nothing. Zero. Otherwise you might say genes pass on the information. Zero. Is there any fraud? They check it out. There's no fraud, there's no money involved. Is there any other, what mechanism can you give which allows these two lives to be linked? He's asking the science lobby. He said, I'm a professor. He said, I'm a scientist. I'm not here to prove anything. I'm simply saying the only theory that will allow me to link up these two lives is the theory of the Hindus of reincarnation. So this is where we sit. So it's serious research. And by the way, this is an ongoing thing. It's not finished yet. If you go on Google now and look for somebody called James, a young boy, American boy, this is a very recent story, and this is not made up, it's very serious stuff. And this boy, from very young age, started talking about, look up the story, but this boy remembered his previous life as a fighter pilot over Japan who was shot down. And they checked everything out, it fitted. And NBC and ABC all interviewed the little chap again and again. This is on Google now, you can see all the interviews, and you see how genuine it is. So it is very real. There is enough proof for me to say, yes, I agree with that.
Free e-learning course in Hinduism. To register, please visit www.hindu-academy.com.
Talks on Hinduism, sponsored by People Care, encouraging caring for the elderly in their own homes. For more information, please visit peoplecare.com.